The suitcases had been tied to the top of the car, but when they stopped for gas, they were gone. They had fallen off somewhere along the remote 70 miles that they had just traveled. How could God ever help them get their luggage back? The answer will surprise you next on this episode of Better Life Today. Hello and welcome to this episode of Better Life Today. With me is Sayuri Rodriguez. Sayuri, welcome.
Thank you.
We're doing our favorite program again.
Yes.
And that is Stories of Faith. Before we start, though, can I share a praise report?
Yes, please.
You know what a praise report is, folks. It's when you want to tell what God has done for you special.
Right.
A number of years ago, I was needing to buy a new car. Mm-hmm. So I prayed to the Lord. I didn't pray for a sports car. You know, we want to sometimes. I didn't pray for this. I said, Lord, I just need a reliable car, a modest, reliable car that won't leave me stranded somewhere along against the highway. And so I prayed that prayer. I went out and went looking, and I looked around, and I found what I thought was just the one. Mm. And I got a good price for it and everything. And you know, that car at the time of this recording is about 14 years old.
Oh.
I bought it, I think, when it was 2 years old, because I buy it used.
Uh-huh.
But it's now been going 14 years.
That's the same car that you have.
And I just passed 300,000 miles on it. In fact, it went so high, the odometer stopped working.
Huh.
It only was made to go up to 300,000 miles.
Wow.
So now I don't even know what I kind of know what the mileage is because I turned on the trip meter. But now I'm beginning to wonder, is it ever going to die? Because it just keeps going and going and going, and it's worked very well. So the Lord answered my prayer. That is my praise report.
God is faithful.
Yeah. We also do something at the beginning of the program, though, regularly. We talk about the kids. If you're following this program in order, chronological order, you know in our last program we talked about the fact that, Sayuri, your foster kids were finally moved on to a family.
Yes.
The part of their family.
Mm-hmm.
And you had had them for about 7 months.
That's
we had
right.
been sharing about them, talking about them. We had all fallen in love with them. And I think the audience kind of had too.
Yeah.
So, but you wanted to talk a little more about them, even though they're with their new family right now.
Mm-hmm. Well, you mentioned that the audience also kind of knows them.
Yes.
Because of the stories and everything. Mm-hmm. It's very beautiful for me to have people call and ask for them. And recently, the calls, when they ask for them, I tell them, oh, they're not with us anymore. And every single person that has asked for the kids, mm-hmm. when they hear that they're not with us anymore, they've all encouraged me and have said that they're going to be praying for us. And that means so much to my husband and I because we need the prayers. We miss them. And we know that it's a change. So for a little one, you know, they do need the prayers. And
yes.
I thank you for doing that.
When you say they ask for them, you mean they ask about them?
Yes.
They recognize you on the phone and they ask,
right.
How are the kids doing?
Right, yes. And well, the kids loved this program.
Mm-hmm.
Every night we used to put the program on the computer.
Uh-huh.
And they wouldn't be able to watch it, but they would hear it.
Oh.
And towards the last days that they were here, we decided to bring both of the kids to the studio.
So let me get this straight. The kids are watching this program.
This program.
On your computer.
Yes.
Each night
so
before they go to sleep.
So every night before they go to sleep, we would go hug, kiss, pray with them.
Uh-huh.
And then they would say, can we have the stories, please? Can we hear the stories? Uncle Dougie's stories and so. So we were like, okay, sure. And we would play and they would be hearing as they were laying down
uh-huh.
trying to fall asleep. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they would want two stories. Other times one story and they were
asleep.
But we decided to bring them to the studio one day.
Uh-huh.
And both of them were here. And it was really interesting because as you and I were recording, my husband was taking care of our little boy
yeah.
and our little girl, somebody else was taking care of her. But it was really cute because since they have not watched the program like you are doing right now, they just heard the program. Our little guy just went to the side and he kind of just laid down listening to what we were doing as we were recording.
Just like you would at home.
Yes. Aww. Now, at the end of the program, I wanted to take some pictures of them here in this in the set.
In these chairs.
Mm-hmm, these chairs. Yeah. So they came here, and do you remember what happened?
Yes, it was so funny because I was off to the side, but I heard them, and the little boy started talking about, he started saying the words that I would say.
Yeah, he was pretending to be Uncle Doug.
He was pretending to be Uncle Doug, and the little girl was pretending to be you.
Yes.
And we actually have a clip. You yes. took a little recording. Now, because there were foster kids, we can't show their faces, so you kind of pixelated the video.
Right.
And we can't say their names, but hopefully the audience can hear their little voices. Now, in case you have a trouble listening, I wrote down what they say.
Okay. Yes.
So the clip you're about to see, the kids, the little boy says, he's sitting in this chair that I'm in right now. He says, on this episode of Better Life Today, welcome, welcome, Sayuri, he says. And he's talking to his little sister in your chair. And in your chair, she says, welcome. And little boy says, no, you have to say thank you.
Yes.
So then the little girl says, thank you. Now, that, in that short clip, that's what we have to show right
yes,
now, right?
That's right.
Okay, let's take a look and see how they did.
In this episode of Better Life Today, welcome, welcome, Sayuri. Welcome. No, you have to say thank you. Thank you.
They had it memorized.
They did. They knew what we said each
yes.
time.
Yes. And sometimes he would say, wait, he didn't do it the way that he's supposed to do it. Like he would pick up on you and, oh, he didn't say it right. And he was just so cute.
You know, there's an important lesson here, Sayuri. You played these things for the kids during the 7 months they were with you. But it wasn't just this. Now, you don't have television in your home.
No.
So the kids weren't watching cartoons. They weren't watching the comedy shows where people swear at each other and where they're disrespectful to each other. You didn't give them that to watch.
No.
What kinds of things did you give the kids?
We had DVDs that we were able to use, Bible stories, songs, just all that had to do with Jesus. And the faith stories that we would watch on YouTube.
Yeah.
And it was really sweet because the stories, they just helped them to know how great God is. So after the stories, the next morning, did you hear the story? And they would talk to each other about, oh, did you hear about the lady that had, you know, they had bees and then the raccoons came to eat them and all these different things. But what I started noticing is because we were not playing other things, all they could talk about was Bible characters and how great God is. So they would be, we would be driving and they would say, sister, he would say to his sister, did you know that God is bigger than that mountain? Or they would say, oh, he runs faster than that car. And all about how big, how great God was.
So the world that you were providing for them, they were surrounded by things of God. And so they would think of these things naturally.
Yes.
That is such an important lesson, folks. If you have young people, maybe you're a parent, or maybe you're a grandparent, it's very important what you feed your kids mentally. I mean, day after day, we have kids who are watching terrible stuff on television. And it's not even overtly bad, but it's just the way that they deal with life. There's never God in it. They're disrespectful to each other. They call each other names, and nowadays it's a lot of bad language. And that's what the kids are putting in their heads. But on the other side of it, you were putting in the kids' heads everything about God.
Right.
So that when they got together, they had things to talk about God.
That's right.
So much better.
And you mentioned that this is very good for grandparents or if you have kids, but it's really good for all of us.
Yes.
I had a lady yesterday that told me that she got rid of her cable. And so now she goes, I started thinking about it and I thought, why am I paying all this money to watch all these different programs when the only one that I need is Better Life for her in this case? And she said, that's all I want in my mind. I want my mind to be pure, she mentioned. And so it's for little ones, but all of us should be very careful with what we watch, what we see, just different things, you know?
Well, we need to get into our stories. This is part of the stories, but we need to get into our other stories.
Yes.
But we have a Bible text for today.
Yes.
What is that?
It is a beautiful Bible text that it's found in Isaiah 42, 12. And it says, let them give glory to the Lord and declare his praise in the coastlands.
Do you know why I like that verse? Because our studios are by the coastlands.
Yes.
We're by the beach. We can be there in about an hour, hour and a half. And so we're declaring God's glory along the coast.
Amen.
Along the coastlands. Mm-hmm. And by telling these stories of what he has done for people.
Amen. So,
I also wanted to mention, you had mentioned earlier that the kids were watching this program on the computer.
Yes.
We've put the programs on YouTube. Mm-hmm. So if you want to watch the programs or see the ones you missed, or you want to share a program with somebody you know, any part of the world, you can go to YouTube, find that program. All you have to search for is Better Life Stories of Faith, and pretty much it comes right up on YouTube. Right. And then you can share those stories. Mm-hmm. But do you know, at the time of this recording, do you know what number program this is of faith stories?
It's 21.
21.
Yeah.
Can you believe we've done 21 half-hour programs talking about all the wonderful things God has done?
And we have a waiting list of all these different stories that we still have to get to.
Every time you look at it, you think, you know, where's the next story is going to come from? They come from somewhere.
Amen.
Because God is busy. The angels are busy. Things mm-hmm. are happening. And when people share them, we can share them Amen. With the audience. So, mm-hmm. But we had a story we wanted to start with. You heard the tease at the very beginning. Yeah. These people lost their luggage. Do you want to hear that story?
Please.
Okay.
Yes.
My friend, I don't know how this came up. We were probably talking about this program. But I have friends that live down in San Diego. And as we were talking, they said, I got a story to share. And so he actually went to the trouble of writing it up and mailing it to me. And I said, well, I looked it over, and I said, there's so many details, and he did such a good job of writing it up. I better read this one.
Okay.
Because I don't want to miss any of the parts. I'm going to get started here.
All right.
Here we go. This is a story I'd mentioned to you that was our miracle experience. Mm-hmm. It was 1970, and we were living in Walla Walla, Washington. We got word, this is my friend, his wife's mother was in critical condition in the hospital in Westminster, California. Mm-hmm. So they all pile into their little Volkswagen Squareback. You know how little those cars
yeah.
are? They all piled in the back of that and headed for California. In addition to my wife, I had our three children, plus his wife's sister and her two boys. Can you imagine all those people crammed into that little Squareback? So they pile in the back of the car and they're gonna go down and see grandma. The only, needless to say, it was cramped.
Oh, yeah.
The only thing that helped was that I had built a small set of bunk beds that were positioned behind the front seat. Where would you put bunk beds? They must have been little shelves. Hmm. I'm hoping these kids were very small.
Yeah.
Because that's the only way you could fit into a small car uh-huh. like that. We decided to take the inland route because it was a holiday weekend and we were concerned about traffic on the other route. Hmm. The inland route took us through McDermott, Oregon and Winnemucca, Nevada. I drove the first leg to McDermott and my sister-in-law drove to Winnemucca. When we arrived in Winnemucca, we were getting gas and we realized that my sister-in-law's suitcases that were tied to the roof were missing.
Oh, no.
Have you ever had that experience? Or you don't want to have that experience. You're driving along, you're on a trip,
right.
and you get out of the car and something's gone. Mm. You don't want to have that. Well, I'm going to get to the rest of the story, but we need to take a short break.
Okay.
What are these folks going to do, you know? We'll find out next. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Hello and welcome back to Better Life Today. We're telling an amazing story of some people who've lost their luggage, if you were with us a minute ago. And these folks had gone on a trip. They needed to go see grandma. She wasn't doing well. And as they were driving along, they stopped to get gas. They look on the roof and their luggage is missing. Two suitcases. Where did they go? They had just driven 70 miles since they last checked. It could be anywhere along those 70 miles. Let's get back to the story. I drove the first leg to McDermott. My mm-hmm. sister-in-law drove to Winnemucca. When we arrived in Winnemucca, we were getting gas when we realized my sister-in-law's suitcases that had been tied to the roof were missing. She had just bought her boys all new clothes.
Oh.
And this is for the year. And they were in the missing suitcases. So you can imagine it wasn't just missing suitcases. It was all the clothes they had just bought.
Wow.
Needless to say, she was very upset, as she was in the College of Nursing School and she had little money. We decided to backtrack the 70 miles to McDermott to look for them, where they were last verified that they were on the top of the car. It was nighttime, so we drove slowly back over our route with my sister-in-law and I in the front seats, and it was quiet except for my wife and the children in the back praying they would find the suitcases.
Mm.
So they're looking up front, they're watching the road. In the back is his wife and the kids praying we find the suitcases. My wife had just attended a series of meetings by Elder Kuhn entitled The Power of Prayer.
Mm.
And she had been very positively affected. And they were praying nonstop. And we were getting agitated by all the praying, my friend is saying. And I said, can you just be quiet? We're trying to find the suitcases. Well, we didn't find them with 2 hours of searching. Oh. We left our name with the local police and drove to see Grandma before it was too late. Because it was late and the next leg of our trip was in the sparsely populated central Nevada where we couldn't find a gas station open. Mm. The next part of the trip was there. Gas stations back there weren't open today all the time. So you had to find one that was open to get gas. Okay. So we talked and decided to drive on to Bishop, California. Because the gas tank was so small in the Volkswagen, I brought along a gallon of gas, which I had placed in the trunk, which happened to be in the front of the car. When I decided it was time to add the emergency gas, we were near Lee Vining, California, and had approximately another 60 miles to go to Bishop. When I stopped to add the gasoline, I had to pry the hood open with a screwdriver because it was frozen shut from the cold. After I added the gas, we drove on to Bishop, where we filled up with gas. The little car took the maximum amount. It was virtually empty when we arrived in Bishop. We visited Grandma. She was improving, so we headed home. We arrived home on Thursday. So they made the trip. They got to see Grandma. The two suitcases were missing. They never found them on the road. Mm. Was God done with the story? No, not at all. As we were welcoming the Sabbath in, there was a knock on the front door. When I answered it, there stood a friend and his wife with the two lost suitcases.
A friend?
A friend of my friend and that man's wife were standing at the door. And with them were the two lost suitcases.
Wow.
Can you believe that? Here's what our friend told us. He said that he and his wife had been at a family reunion in Caldwell, Idaho for the holiday weekend. His wife's aunt and uncle were driving from San Francisco to Caldwell, Idaho for the reunion. When they saw two suitcases on the highway. So this other couple, their relatives are driving along. They see the suitcases. They stop and pick them up. Okay, great. Hmm. But how's that going to help them?
Right.
They found them on that lonely desert road between Winnemucca and McDermott. They picked them up and took them to the reunion where our friends recognized my sister-in-law's name. So they delivered the suitcases to us as my sister-in-law lived with us at the time. So there you have it, he says. We lost the suitcases 500 miles from home, and an Adventist couple found them traveling from San Francisco to Caldwell, and our friends delivered them to our front door.
Wow.
So here they thought they had lost the suitcases. They thought, most likely, that God had not answered their prayer, not realizing that God had special delivery planned for that coming Friday night.
Hmm.
Isn't that amazing?
Nothing is impossible for God.
That is
amazing. Praise God.
Now you have a story to share.
I have a story. And this one is also about something that was lost.
Okay.
When we were living in Grants Pass, mm-hmm. we were asked if we would like to be the new pastor for the Roseburg Church, the Better Life Roseburg Church. Now, before we moved there, there had to be an interview. And I remember the day of the interview came, and we were praying about it. We had been praying about it for a long time. And when the day of the interview came, that morning I started reading my Bible, and I was a little bit nervous because as much as you always have a plan and you go, oh, yeah, this will be wonderful, in our case, we really want to make sure that we're in the same page with the Lord and that this is from the Lord. This mm-hmm. is God's will. Mm-hmm. So I kept praying and praying, Lord, every door seems to be opening. But even if this is not your will, you can close all the doors today if you want to. But I'm praying and praying, and I said, everything seems to be pointing, yes, that we are to accept this call to go and pastor at the Roseburg Church. Mm-hmm. But that morning, I read my devotional, and in my Bible, I read Psalm 1, the part where it says that the righteous shall be as a tree planted by
waters.
And I remember thinking, Lord, I don't usually do this, but today, the day of the interview, I am praying that you would give us a sign that this is your will. Mm-hmm. And so I would like to see a tree, a specific tree that I know this is from you, mm-hmm. and water. And that's going to tell me that this is a sign. This is, comes from you. But we live in Oregon, and there's a million trees.
That's
you know,
right.
There's so many trees, and there's a river, you know, that goes by them. And so as we were driving from Grants Pass to Roseburg, mm-hmm. we're driving, and I'm looking, I'm thinking, there's going to be a tree that is just going to take my attention. I know there's so many, but one is going to... It's just going to take my attention. But nothing, I mean, they were all green, tall, beautiful, but nothing super out of the ordinary. And as we're driving, there's a river, so there's the water, there's lots of trees, but there has to be something specific. When we get to the church, we pray again. I open my eyes, and we could have driven to the back of the church, mm-hmm. but no, God said, you know, drive to the front of the church, park right there. We park, we prayed. When I open my eyes and we get out of the car, I would like you to see what I was able to, to see with my eyes.
Let's
Please, let's see this video. You see that tree right next to the church?
Oh,
that
yeah.
big, big tree? I remember thinking, wow, this is a beautiful tree. And then I turned. And do you see what I see?
You saw the water.
The water.
Oh.
The water. We've never had a church where there was a pond, water right next to it. And I remember praising God and just saying, Lord, we understand what you're saying. Well, yes, you know, the church asked for us after the interview, mm-hmm. and we were able to say yes with confidence because we knew that this came from the Lord.
Oh, that's wonderful. See, we always often talk about the Lord being interested in the big things and the little things.
Yeah.
This was a medium thing.
Uh-huh.
It wasn't life and death, but it was important
right.
for your ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord gave you that little verification, go.
Amen.
What have you found at Roseburg since you've been there?
Oh, so many blessings and so many people that we believe that God brought us to that place, including the kids.
Oh,
you
yes.
know?
You would have not met the kids
no.
if you had not been here. What a beautiful thing.
Amen.
Well, you know, we've asked the audience to send in their stories,
mm-hmm.
share their stories with us.
Yes.
And so I did get a call one day,
mm-hmm.
and this lady said, I want to share my testimony too.
Mm-hmm.
And so I took notes,
yes.
and I said, okay, let's see what happened. This happened a number of years ago, but it stayed with her because the Lord's mercies were still in her mind. This was 1969. Now, she says she was working with a ministry down in Southern California. She was driving along, and she was involved in an incident with a drunk driver. She said the crash was so strong that she was in the front of the car, I think she was driving, and there was a guy sitting in the back of the car. The guy in the back of the car got thrown forward and pushed her into the windshield. That's how strong this accident was. She said that she was there injured. The accident, she said the blessing was, it happened right in front of a hospital. But she said she was severely injured. She said she was drowning in her own blood. I don't know all the details, but that sounds
mm-hmm.
horrible.
Mm-hmm.
But then she said, I guess she needed a tracheotomy. You know where they put a hole in your throat
uh-huh.
so you can breathe?
Yes.
She needed one. And the accident report says that a doctor came over 2 to 3 minutes after the accident and did that for her. Well, she went to the hospital. She says that she was brain dead for 2 weeks. I don't know if that's the correct term or not, but whatever it was serious.
Yes.
For 2 weeks, they were praying, her friends were praying for her,
mm-hmm.
praying for her recovery. And you know, one day, she woke up. She woke up again.
Mm.
The Lord brought her back. She was still had some of the influences of the accident. She couldn't, what did she tell me? She couldn't taste or smell, but she was alive.
Mm.
The Lord spared her life. She wanted to later thank the doctor who had come over and helped her at the time of the accident. You know, she could never find him.
Wow.
She's wondering, and I'm wondering, did God send an angel to
mm-hmm.
do some medical work on her real quick there to save her life?
Wow.
Because I think she probably wouldn't have made it had he not done that.
Right.
It was incredible. So we're so happy to get your request, I mean, your stories. So if you in the audience are listening and you say, nah, the Lord did something for me too, we want to give you an opportunity to give us a call. The number is going to be on your screen. And you can call us and say, here's my story. You don't need to write it up. If you want to, that's great. I'll give you an email address you can mail it to. But if you just want to tell us,
mm-hmm.
we'll type it up. And maybe we'll be able to share it on a future program. Because
mm-hmm.
so many, you know, we so much want to give glory to God when he does something. Don't hide the incident. Don't just tell a few people.
Mm-hmm.
Let's tell everybody what God is doing.
Right.
So they can see that he's working today.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Well, Sayuri, our time is going real quick. Can you get a story through in just a minute?
I think I can.
Okay.
You know, with the kids gone, it's been very difficult for us. We miss them very much.
Yeah.
And the first Sabbath that the kids left on a Friday.
Mm-hmm.
So Saturday we went to church and I prayed to God and I said, this is going to be hard, Lord. I'm used to coming into the church holding hands.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember walking in. I thought I was ready, but when I walked in, I realized this is hard. And I remember sitting down. And as I was sitting down, I prayed to God and I said, Lord, please help me. This is very difficult. Where are my spiritual children, you know? And at that moment, I felt somebody like holding me and I turned around and it was this young lady from our church. Her mm-hmm. name is Haley. And she came in and she just started talking to me about her school and her plans. And that's what I needed. I needed to talk about something else. And it was so beautiful how God sent this young lady. At the end of the service, we're walking away, and usually we will hold the hands of our kids mm-hmm. and walk and greet people.
Yes.
This little girl, Josie, uh-huh. she came and stood right next to us and started greeting people with us.
Oh.
I believe 100% that angels, or God himself, mm-hmm. impressed on both these girls to come and to be an encouragement for us at that moment that we needed. You see, we may not have the kids with us, but God is so sweet that he gives us spiritual children. That's an answer to prayer.
Isn't that great? Folks, isn't it wonderful to be an answer to somebody's prayer?
Amen.
You know, that should be our prayer. Lord, if you need somebody, here I am.
Amen.
Do you need to encourage somebody? I'll go. Do you need to help somebody? Does somebody need a little bit of money or they need food or something? I'll help.
Amen.
And let that be your prayer today, friends. Anyway, Saidi, we're at the end of the program. And we still have more stories
yes.
we haven't shared. We'll have to do another one. Friends, we're glad you joined us. Please tune in next time for our next Better Life Today.